Welcome, church. Welcome, friends online. Welcome this morning, afternoon, or evening. Welcome to this special day. It's Christmas! And we are gathering now to worship our great God, to celebrate the birth of Jesus through the amazing work of God's Holy Spirit. Today is a birthday. We celebrate. We celebrate Jesus' birth and our rebirth. Today, many of us will celebrate in birthday party style too. We may eat and maybe drink too much. There will be gifts shared, but right now, we're going to focus on the greatest gift of all, God's love gift to us. God's love gift to the whole world. God's love gift to an odd lot. Old people like Zechariah and Elizabeth, Simeon and Anna, a teenager, a carpenter, shepherds, and wise folk, and us. I think we're an odd lot too. All sorts, aren't we? God's love gift in Jesus to us invites us to a response and maybe a gift back. Maybe the gift of loving God in worship right now, and also loving the odd lot around us. So let's worship now.
Now is the time in our worship service where we give of our gifts and offerings. You can see our bank details on the screen right now. Each week we have an opportunity to contribute financially to the wider work of the mission and ministry of the Boronia and Bayswater Church of Christ. And if you'd like to contribute to our work in the community, we'd love to partner with you in this way. So please follow the instructions on the screen or get in contact with the office if you need more assistance. Thanks, friends.
Earth rejoice. Christmas morning. It's so great to be joining with you this morning and celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. So we're really excited about today and we hope you've had a wonderful morning at home. In our house, it was a wonderful morning. It's always an early morning in our house, which is a surprise because most days I have to wake people up to get out of bed. But not on Christmas Day. Everybody's up bright and early, ready to check out what's under the tree. It's chaotic, it's messy, but it's wonderful, a great celebration. We hope that you have had a wonderful morning, and as you're tuning in and joining with us in celebration, we are hoping that you're experiencing the joy of this Christmas season. You know, as I think about Christmas, I've been thinking a little bit this year about that carol, I'll Be Home for Christmas. Now, it's not my favourite carol, to be honest. It's a bit dirgy and, you know, it's not really going anywhere. I love the rah-rah kind of carols. But because we've had such an intense year and many of us haven't seen people that we love and people that we normally see, it's kind of an appropriate carol that we'll all finally get to see one another face to face. And that's a real celebration if that's possible for you this year. I remember many years ago when I was a teenager, still a teenager, but nearly an adult, and my brother had moved to England and then Africa. He was away for a couple of years, and he was my closest brother. We were good companions growing up, and so I really missed him when he went away. And as it was coming close to Christmas, my dad said, "Oh, look, I've got a courier coming who's going to take some things to your brother, so get some things ready, write a letter, record a cassette," that's how long ago it was, "and, you know, put some things together and it will be taken over to meet him overseas." Because, you know, up until then we'd been on the phone, that was very expensive, so we hardly did it. And the other thing we're doing, we're writing letters. There was no email and internet, no Zoom in those days, and so, you know, our contact was really sporadic, and you had to wait weeks for the letters to come, and, you know, all those things. So we gathered our things, Mum and I put packs together to be taken over to my brother overseas, and then we waited for the courier to arrive. And someone did arrive, but it happened to be my brother, who my dad had organised to come home for Christmas, and it was a really lovely celebration. You know, all the letters and the phone calls were good, but to be able to hold him and squeeze and say hello and hear his voice and see that he was okay was such a lovely surprise and such a lovely gift to us. And, you know, I think as we think about Christmas this year, and as we think about gathering together, maybe there's going to be a bit of squeezing going on. Well, as we come to God's scripture today and we hear this ancient text that says to us, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." What we recognize is that God, who had sent letters and sent messengers to the earth for years, thousands of years, had finally not just sent a letter or sent a messenger, but God himself had come home for Christmas. He was the promised one from hundreds of years earlier with Isaiah, and here he was in the flesh, squeezable, or there was a baby, so you don't want to squeeze too tight. And I know that Israel was probably hoping that when the Saviour came that had been promised, that God would deliver Israel from Rome. They were in occupation at the time, and so they were being overtaxed, and all the taxes were going to expand the empire, and the local towns were not experiencing the flourishing. In fact, they felt quite under pressure. And so, you know, as they were thinking about this Saviour, I think in their mind, as they imagined God coming to save them, they were thinking about prosperity for Israel in the moment. But God's gift wasn't a temporary solution to a short-term problem. God's gift of salvation was for all humankind, for all time. It wasn't temporary. And so as we come to the Nativity, and I've got my little Nativity here, I hope you like it. It packs up really nicely, which is great. But as we come to the Nativity and as we gaze into the manger, what we find is that the heart of God, the face of God, is turned towards humankind. He is present and with us. Often we think of God as lofty and far away and beyond our understanding. And actually, that's true. If we were to see God face to face, we would close our mouth and bow our knees most likely. But as God comes in human form, as a baby, he comes in such a way that we can experience the face of God in kindness, in compassion, in love, in presence, in an earthly kind of way. God is personally involved. He's invested in our human life, and we can see that as he engages in the dirt, in the dust, in the everyday and ordinary life. I don't know if you felt like that this year. There are moments this year where we probably all said, God, where are you? This is year number two of a rough time. And sometimes we've wondered, does God love me? Is everything going to be okay? Does he really care? And the Nativity invites us to see and to know. It, with its broad brushstroke of who's in the room, it helps us understand that God's love is for everyone, for each one of us. It's personal. We're represented in the Nativity in a way that God helps us know he does love us. He does care. He is present and he is personally involved. I mean, have a look at the Nativity. There's Dad, tired, pressured, maybe he's insecure, carrying the weight of everyone's expectations. Maybe he's looking brave, but feeling inside afraid. And then there's Mum. And is she exhausted? I know many mums were exhausted this year. Is she elated with the birth of her new baby, but afraid and frustrated? Maybe she feels like she has to sleep with one eye open and full of mother guilt because her baby's lying in a manger with hay, not in a beautiful crib somewhere safe. And then there are the shepherds. I haven't got any shepherds in my nativity here, but they're a small crowd of lower class, second-rate fellows. They're blue-collar workers who are uneducated, rejected by society, and perhaps even a little bit socially awkward. And yet, here they are, people that are necessary to society, but not valued. They're overworked and underpaid, and perhaps we can find ourselves identifying with them. And then there are the wise men. They're wealthy and wise, having everything that they want and in the very best brand, having gone to the best schools and connected with the right people in society. Yet they're there and they're still searching for what is missing in their lives. And then there's the donkey. No, I'm not going to compare people to a donkey, but I love the donkey in the story. It just reminds us we are all represented in the story of the Nativity. So somewhere in this brushstroke of the Nativity, we find ourselves, and there in the middle of it all, in the hay and the dirt, is God himself, wrapped in cheap cloth and lying on dirty hay. He's not in a bolt of lightning or a flash. He's not coming thundering in with miracle power. He's not even there, tender and mild, sleeping in heavenly peace. God is there, present as an ordinary baby, and God is home for Christmas. He's not a message through a messenger. He's God himself in his fullness, dwelling in a tiny infant that you can smell and touch and squeeze and hear and speak to. All that Isaiah promised has come to pass. That God is tangibly present. And that's what the Nativity speaks to us about, that God has come home for Christmas, that he cares and that his face is towards us, and we can see that in this Nativity. But you might say to me, well, it's a long time ago, Beck. That's a long time ago, and I can't squeeze God anymore. And this is the kind of year I really would have liked. to have a squeeze from God or a squeeze from anybody. We've been so isolated for so long. And it's true. Jesus' incarnation was 2,000 years ago, and physically he no longer lives on earth. We celebrate an event that has happened. But we don't just celebrate an event that has happened. You see, when Jesus came to the earth, when he lived his life, he died and rose again, he left his Holy Spirit here when he returned to heaven. He left himself here on earth, not just in one tiny baby, but accessible for every single human being. Presence of the living God dwells among the people of God and is accessible for anybody, Joel tells us. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will find the presence of the Spirit and his outpouring upon them. And so today, as we celebrate Christmas, we recognize not only was the baby born 2,000 years ago, but the living presence of God in his Spirit remains with us today. And he's tangible. I mean, sometimes we miss it. Sometimes we miss it because we're rushing and fluffing and flapping and shopping and sleeping when we get a chance. And sometimes we miss that God is with us now. But here in this moment, here in this few moments of quiet, before the day rustles on, we can pause and breathe in the presence of God and notice his tangible, weighty peace. He is still the wonderful Counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And all of these gifts are for you today. He has joy for your weary body. He has peace for your weary mind. And he has love for your heart that has weighed heavy burdens this year. So I want to encourage you today, pay attention. See and notice the tangible presence of God as he turns up in your moments. Don't miss them. Don't rush past them. Pause for a moment when you see his actions in kindness, in love, in peace, and in joy. And as you hold your friends or family or neighbors closely, squeeze them a little bit tighter and remember that they are the image of God, and in them is the presence of God also. So listen to their voice and share in their laughter and watch them smile and remember the Spirit of God is with you. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you the presence of the living God with you as you go about today. And I want to encourage you to remember your place in the manger, in the nativity, and see where God is reaching into your world. Let's pray. Lord, as we gather around the manger story, we remember that this tiny baby is your gift of your presence with us. We thank you that you didn't want heaven without us, so you brought heaven near. We thank you that in the Christ child, nothing can separate us from your love anymore. Right now, we recognize the gift of your Holy Spirit. And in this quiet moment, we invite the tangible presence of the Spirit to fall on and refill each one of us today. We breathe you in. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. May the Spirit of the Christ Child, who fills us now, go with us as we celebrate this day. And may we share with those we live, laugh, and play with. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God bless you. Have a wonderful day today. And we'll look forward to seeing you again next time.